Good evening and welcome to, you know, I've been reading through with everyone, or reading through the Torah, because to me, it is absolutely the best way of understanding what's in it. You just have to read it, whether we read it in English or whatever language. It's always best to know Hebrew, of course. And I know a bit, which has helped me over the years. So last night when we were supposed to have our what's called Torah 101, and I'd like to change the name to Torah for Everyone, because it absolutely is for everyone. So last night there was a blackout, no electricity, so I couldn't do it last night. And then instead of gathering people together tonight, I decided to just read it. And whatever I was going to say last night, I'll say tonight. So if you will bear with me, let me share the screen and let's go to, we're in the book of Numbers, Bamidbar. And the portion goes from Numbers 4:21 to chapter 7, verse 89. Now I'm reading it from a version called Mekron Mamre. It's in Old English. So sometimes I'll skip over parts and just, or change some of the words. But here it says, the Lord spoke to Moses saying, take a sum of the sons of Gershon by their father's houses, by their families. So basically what he's saying, he's taking a census. He's counting the sons of Gershon. And who is Gershon? He's the eldest son of Levi. Levi is one of the 12 tribes. And I think first you have Reuben. And I think then there was Levi is a second son, and then there was Simeon, and the fourth one was Judah. So these are the sons of Aaron and Levi. The Levites were chosen to take care of the temple, and now they're going to be inaugurated. Now they're going to be told what to do. And they had to choose them, it says, from 30 years old and up until 50 years old. You shall count them. So it's not the same as the physical army. In last week's portion, we read about how God chose the 600 odd thousand young men from 20 years and up to serve in the Israeli forces. This was the first Israeli army, because he knew traveling through the desert, we would be at war with all our enemies. But this one here is a little bit of a different type of an army. He's going to be forming a spiritual army. And they had to be 30 to 50. So it was only a 20-year period that they could serve. And it's basically because the work, as we'll see, is such manual labor. It was such hard work that at 50 years old, their bodies probably would have had enough. See, the Torah is very down to earth. It really deals with very physical things, even though we are a soul, a neshama, a spirit inside a physical body, we must take care of the physical body. A lot of the religions, the Eastern religions, the religions like Christianity as well, the old-fashioned Christianity, they were very into asceticism, where you have to kill the body, you have to destroy the body, you have to make the body submit. But Judaism is not like that. Judaism understands, biblical Judaism understands that we're living in this body, God made the body, and we are to take care of it. And we are to live on this planet and rejoice and enjoy the body that we're in, which is very different from religions. Okay, so now it says, all who enter in, meaning to the Mishkan, to wait upon the service, to do service in the Ochel Moed, the tent of meeting. So the Levites were going to be the ones who perform all the services in the tent of meeting. Now, each one of the beginning with the Gershonites, they would all be given very specific things to do. It's very clear, like last time, a few weeks ago when I spoke and I said, if you see the firemen, when they're called to a fire, the leader, the head, the chief, says, okay, you guys do this, you guys do that, you guys do that. And they were to stick to what they were supposed to do so that everybody would be safe. And that's the same thing here. So this is the service of the Gershonim. They would bear the curtains of the tabernacle and the tent of meeting, the coverings of the, they say sealskin, but there were no sealskins in the desert. So it was some kind of leather that was above it. The screen for the door, you see, very specific. The hangings of the court, the screen for the door of the gate of the court, which is by the tabernacle, Hamishkan, and by the altar around the Mizbeach Saviv, the altar around, their cords, the instruments of service, and whatever there would be to do with them, that's how they would serve. At the commandment of Aaron, so Aaron had to order, and his sons, shall be all the service of the sons of the Gershonim. So they were to answer directly to Aaron in everything they do, in all their burdens, all their servants, their service, and you shall appoint them in charge of all their tasks. Now, this is the service of the family of the sons of the Gershonim in the Ochel Moed. Their charge shall be under the hand of Itamar, the son of Aaron the priest. So the Gershonim again was under Itamar and Aaron, the son. Itamar was the son of Aaron. As for the sons of Merari, so we have Gershon, and Merari is the next son of Levi. You shall count them by their families, by their father's houses. Again, 30 year old and up. And they would be given different things. Here we see they're given, they had to take care of the boards of the Mishkan, its bars, the pillars, the sockets, the pillars of the courts, the pins, and anything that appertained to that part of the service. By name, you shall appoint the instrument of the charge of their burden, what they had to do. This is the service of the families of the sons of Merari, according to all their service in the tent of meeting, under the hand of Itamar, the son of Aaron. So Itamar would be directly in charge of handling what these two families had to do. Aaron was the top, then his sons, and now the Levites would work with Aaron, who was the father of all the Kohanim. Moses and Aaron, and the Nisi, the princes of the congregations, all the leaders, the heads, counted the sons of the Kohatites by their family, the Kohatim. So that was the third son, Kahat, and by their father's house. Again, 30 years old and up to 50. Now they were numbered 2,750. They were numbered the families of the Kohati, of all who served in the Ochel Moed, who Moses and Aaron numbered according to the commandment of the Lord by the hand of Moses. They were counted, the sons of Gershon, 30 years and older. It's repeated again, because when God repeats, he wants us to pay attention. And for me here, our rabbi always says, let's stand back and see what the bigger picture is here. What was God telling us? We had these three men. They were numbered. They were given very specific tasks, and they were not to do anything that anybody else was called to do. And it's like that for us. When we're given something to do, we need to do it and not look at what everybody else is doing. I remember when we had some people, there were several gentlemen. I don't even know if we can call them gentlemen, but they were serving in our community. And they would always say to the rabbi, people respect you because you have a title and they know who you are. And so they respect you. We want a title. But they weren't serving. All they wanted was the title. And when they were finally given the title, they became like dictators. Okay, now according to the commandment of the Lord, these men were appointed Aliad de Moshe, by the hand of Moses, everyone to his own service, to his own burden. They were counted as the Lord commanded Moshe. Now, chapter 5. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, command the children of Israel that they put out of the camp every leper. Now, this is the one who had tzaarat. Everyone who has an issue, some kind of a leak, so to speak, some kind of a discharge. Whoever is unclean by the dead, anyone who was who went close to someone who was dead, who was pronounced unapproachable to God. That was basically what the issue is. When we are to bring offerings in the tent of meeting, when we were to bring any offering to God, it was always to be the very best. So if anyone had a disease, leprosy, tzaarat in those days was caused by lashon hara, the evil tongue. We saw that with Miriam when she spoke behind the back of her brother Moses to Aaron, and the two of them gossiped about the brother. Who does he think he is? We also are prophets. We also are called by God. And they stirred up trouble in the camp. And so here, and they came, Miriam came down with tzaarat, which was a skin disease. She was put outside the camp for 7 days and then brought back in. So here, everyone who had tzaarat had to be put outside the camp until they would be pronounced clean by the Kohen. Both male and female shall you put outside the camp so that they do not defile the camp in the midst of where I dwell, meaning God's dwelling. God wants a clean camp. And when we stand back and take a look at this picture, it's a picture for us to see what in us is not right. So for us to be able to be in the presence of our God. The children of Israel did that, put them outside the camp. As the Lord spoke to Moses, so did the children of Israel. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel. Now, this is very important. I want you to pay attention to this. Please listen to this for all those who have been, I would say, brainwashed by religion. This is what the Torah says. Remember, Torah is for everyone. When a man or woman commits any sin that men tend to commit a trespass against the Lord, what would those be? We already know he brought us to Mount Sinai. He gave us the Ten Commandments. If we broke them, we were trespassing against the Lord, and that soul would be guilty. Then it says, then they shall acknowledge, confess their sin. To who? They would take an animal. They would go to the Kohen. They would acknowledge their sin, which they have done. And look at the next thing. That person needed to make restitution for his guilt in full. If he took something from someone, he had to give it back. And look what he had to do. Add unto it the fifth part of it. So he had to add a fifth. And not only did he have to make restitution of what he took, but he had to add interest. Give it to him in respect of whom he has been guilty. So we see that it's not just in Christianity. There's a belief that somebody has to die for our sins in order for our sins to be forgiven. This is not what Torah says. They confess their sin. They bring the animal to the Kohen. They make things right. We are responsible for our own sin, each and every man. And that's all throughout the Tanakh. But if the man has no kinsman, no relative to whom to make restitution for his guilt, then it goes to the priest, the Kohanim. It brings it directly to the Lord. Besides the ram, they bring an offering. The word here for atonement is really important. It's yekaper. Kaper means covering. We put a kippa on, a covering for the head. We stand under the chuppah when we get married, a covering. A kapara is the covering. It's like God saying, here, I accept this animal from you, and I've got it covered. This is what the Torah is teaching us. And every offering of all the holy things of the children of Israel, meaning the things that were set apart for God, which they present to the Kohen, shall be his, meaning the Kohen's. Every man's hallowed things. Hallowed means kadosh, means set apart, shall be his. Whatever any man gives to the Kohen, it shall be his. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, if a man's wife goes astray, oh, this part is called the sota, which means the wife of the jealous husband. So here we're dealing with some rules and regulations that were very common at that time. And I'll read what the Torah says, and then I'll tell you what one of the codices of that time was, the Hammurabi Codex. Every area had its code. If you went into a new village, they would have their own code of behavior. Here, the Torah is giving a code of behavior for our people. So here, if a man's wife goes astray and is unfaithful, and a man lies with her carnally, they have relations, and it's hidden from the eyes of her husband, she was defiled in secret, and because there was no witness against her, neither shall she be caught in the act. But the spirit of jealousy comes upon the husband, and he's jealous of his wife, and that she may be defiled. Or if the spirit of jealousy comes upon him, and he who is jealous of his wife, even though she is not defiled. So either she could be or she couldn't be, but something in him is, he's worried. Something's wrong. So this is what he had to do. The man had to bring his wife to the Kohen and bring her offering for her. He was to bring a tenth part of an ephah of barley meal. So some grain, a grain offering with no oil on it, nor frankincense. These were very specific offerings for a very different type of sin. But this one was just to bring the barley meal. It is a meal offering of jealousy, of memorial, bringing iniquity to remembrance. And the Kohen shall bring her near and set her before the Lord. So here the Kohen's taking the offering and coming before God. And the Kohen shall take holy water in an earthen vessel. This is, he had a pot of some kind. And the dust that is on the floor of the tabernacle of the Kohen shall be taken and put in water. Now, at that time, they were bringing the offerings of the red heifer. So the dust that was on the floor would be part of the ashes from the red heifer. And the Kohen shall set the woman before the Lord and let the hair down of the woman go loose, put the meal offering of remembering in her hand, which is a meal offering of jealousy, and the Kohen shall have it in his hand, the water of bitterness that causes a curse. So here the Kohen is telling her that if indeed there's a reason for the husband to be jealous, there will be a curse upon her. And the Kohen shall make her swear an oath and say to the woman, if no man is lain with you, and if you have not been unclean, because your husband is your covering, you shall be free from this water of bitterness that causes a curse. But if you have gone astray while you're still under the covering of your husband, under the chuppah, under the covering of your husband, and if you are defiled and some man has lain with you other than your husband, then the Kohen shall cause the woman to swear with an oath of cursing. And the Kohen shall say to the woman, the Lord make you a curse and an oath among your people. And when the Lord does make your thigh fall away and your belly swell, and this water will cause a curse to go into your bowels, and your belly shall swell and your thigh shall fall away. And the woman shall admit and say, so be it. Amen, amen means so be it. Let it be thus. And the Kohen shall write these curses in a scroll, and he shall blot them out into the water of bitterness. And he shall make the woman drink the water of bitterness that causes the curse. And the water that causes the curse shall enter in her and become bitter. And the priest shall take the meal offering of jealousy out of the woman's hand, and shall wave the meal offering before the Lord and bring it to the altar. And the Kohen shall take a handful of the meal offering as a memorial part and smoke, and afterwards shall make the woman drink the water. And he who has made her drink the water, then it shall come to pass, if she is defiled and has acted unfaithfully against her husband, that the water that causes the curse shall enter into her and become bitter, and her belly shall swell. Her thigh shall fall away, and the woman shall be a curse among her people. But if the woman is not defiled and she's clean, then she shall be cleared and shall conceive. The other woman would be made barren by the curse that was put upon her. Shall conceive seed. This is the law of jealousy. When a wife, being under her husband, goes astray and is defiled, and when the spirit of jealousy comes upon the man and he is jealous about his wife, then he shall set the woman before the Lord, and the Kohen shall execute upon her all this law. It's not law, it's Torah, these instructions. And the woman shall be cleared from iniquity, and that woman shall bear her iniquity. You know, I was thinking, why would almost an entire chapter be devoted to all this, to the jealousy of a woman, the jealousy of the husband if a woman is defiled? It just seems excessive. It seemed excessive to me. But a few things I remembered our rabbi was teaching. And one of them had to do with, I took some notes here. Now, the word in the Talmud for this whole chapter, this whole idea, is called, as I said, sota, which is the jealous husband, the woman of a jealous husband. And I thought, so many verses were dedicated to this. And I said, how important is it to the Lord for God, for women to be faithful to her husband, to not commit adultery? It's interesting, in the Torah, adultery had to do with the woman, because men had several wives. So, and the only way that adultery was brought into the picture was when a woman was married and he slept with a woman, then both of them were to come before the Kohen and both of them were to be stoned. We will see this later. So it's always the man who is the covering, who is responsible for making sure that the woman is safe, is covered. Excuse me. It talks about this in the seventh commandment. the other thing about this chapter, because it seems that it's so archaic, and how could we possibly relate to it today? The Hammurabi Code said, if a woman is found guilty of adultery, if a woman is suspected of adultery and her husband is jealous and brings her to their priest, because there were also priests in a pagan culture, the woman had to jump into a raging river. Some say there were crocodiles in it. Some say that there were just huge waves and it was a raging river. And if she made it to the other side, she was innocent. That seems to be pretty unfair. What God was doing here was working with the superstition of the people of the day. Remember, when many people who are very religious and tend to become very superstitious. And superstition is not from God. God wants us to trust him, not in certain things that we choose to be superstitious about. Like, I know someone, if they enter the room and they haven't kissed the mezuzah, they're afraid something bad is going to happen to them. When I was a kid, people would talk about, oh, don't walk under a ladder because you'll have bad luck. Or if you break a mirror, you'll have bad luck for 7 years. All these superstitions, nothing to do with reality. But here, people were superstitious. And so the Kohen was going to take some dust of the earth, was going to take the offering, mix it together with some holy water and then make her drink it. Now, if she was guilty and she had to make an oath that she was innocent, if she was superstitious, she would be scared to death. And she would never want to drink the water because she believed in curses. Whether curses are real, I doubt it. I don't believe that a curse can do anything to you if you're protected by God. I think a curse is completely psychological. Because if you believe that a curse is real, you make it happen. That's my understanding, my belief, after all that I've seen in the New Age and all the crazy things that I went through. So here what God was doing was taking a pagan ritual, like we saw in the Hammurabi, and working with superstitious people and turning it around so that we would always focus on him, not be superstitious, but she would, if she were innocent, her willingness to take that concoction would be obvious that she was innocent. If she didn't want to take it, it would be obvious that she was guilty. It's a little bit like the story of Solomon and the prostitute with the two children, but that's for another day. So these stories make so much sense when you take them into context of the people of the day. All right, the next chapter is chapter 6. Now here is so we're divided up into the sons of Gershon, Merari, and the Kohatites, what they were supposed to do. Then we see the Sotah, and this part is about the Nazirite, a vow of the Nazir, the Nazir. Now it says, and the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, if either a man or a woman shall clearly utter a vow, the vow of a Nazirite, to consecrate himself to the Lord, he shall abstain from wine and strong drink. Now, he is used to encompass, like in other languages, when you're saying male and female, he is used to encompass both. That's all that this has to do. But here is the case of a man or a woman, when they are curious What is a Kohen? What does it feel like to be a Kohen, or somebody who has to serve God for a period of time? What is that like? Here, God is allowing them for a short period of time, however long they want, to take a vow of the Nazir. And they would consecrate, they would dedicate themselves to God for a period of time. This is what they had to do during that period of time. They would drink no vinegar strong drink, no liquor made from grapes, not even to eat fresh grapes or dried. All the days of his being a Nazir, he shall eat nothing that's made of the grapevine, from the pressed grapes to the grape stone. All the days of his vow of the Nazir, no razor shall come upon his head, which is why in the Haftarah we're reading about Samson. Samson was not supposed to drink. He was not supposed to cut his hair. But unfortunately, he didn't cut his hair, but he certainly liked to drink and he liked women until his days be fulfilled. So it was only for a short period of time in which he would consecrate himself to the Lord. He would dedicate himself to God. He shall be holy, which means separated. Doesn't mean he has a halo. It just means he's going to separate himself for a period of time. Like if someone wanted to go for a period of time, let's say into a monastery and just set themselves apart for that time, then he lets the hair of his head grow long, not to come near a dead body, not to make himself unclean for his father or mother, for his brother or sister when they die, because consecration upon God is on his head. So he has to do everything that the Kohanim were called to do. All the days of the Nazir is holy to the Lord. If any man dies very suddenly next to him and he defiles his holy head, his consecrated head, then he shall shave his head on the day of his cleansing. On the seventh day shall he shave it. And the eighth day he's to bring two turtle doves, two young pigeons to the Kohen, to the door of the Ohel Moed. And the priest shall prepare one for sin offering and the other for olah, burnt offering, and make a covering for him, and for that he sinned by reason of the dead, by having approached the dead. And he shall hallow his head that same day. He shall consecrate to the Lord the days of his Nazirite, and shall bring a male lamb the first year for a guilt offering. But the former day shall be void because his consecration was defiled. So it's almost like he had to start all over again. This is the law of the Nazir. When the days of his consecration are fulfilled, he shall bring it to the door of the tent of meeting. He shall present his offering. You see the very specific things for him to do. Why? Why all these things? We have to always go back to the story of Egypt. When we were slaves in Egypt, we would watch these elaborate ceremonies of the pagan priests and priestesses. Here, God was giving us an elaborate ceremony of what we would need to do. Remember, we were in the desert. We had nothing to do anymore with the temples there. So he had us build our Mishkan, and he would have us to do He would have these people do these offerings in his way. So we would focus then not on the pagan gods, slowly bring our focus away to the one God until we didn't need these things anymore. These would be for a period of time. So we would bring a male lamb in the first year without blemish. Always when we give to God, it has to be the absolute very best of what we're going to offer. If we go visit someone to someone's house and they have a beautiful home and we bring them a gift, we're going to bring the best. It's the same when we present ourselves before God. And it continues with unleavened bread, with flour. And the priest, the Kohen, shall bring them before the Lord and shall offer the sin offering and the burnt offering. And we continue to about all the laws. And it says here, this is the Torah. The word law is just wrong. It's not a law. These are instructions for the Nazarite who vowed and his offering to the Lord of his Nazariteship. So must he do after the Torah of the Netzir. Now, the next part we're going to see here is one we do every Shabbat. We do this. This is the what's called the Aaronic benediction. V'deber Adonai el Moshe lemor. Deber el Aharon v'el b'nei lemor. Koch, he says, speak to Aaron, to his son, saying thus, on this, in this way, you shall bless the children of Israel. You shall say to them, Yivarechecha Adonai v'yishmarecha. Ya'er Adonai panavelecha v'chuneka. Isa Adonai panavelecha v'yasem lecha shalom. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you shalom. So shall they put my name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them. We constantly are looking for the blessings of our Creator. And this is the last chapter here in this portion, chapter 7, right to the end. Now, it came to pass on the day that Moshe had made an end of setting up the tabernacle, the Mishkan, and had anointed it. Now, the word anointed is very important for all those who look at only one Mashiach. In Christianity, they say it's Jesus. In Islam, I'm not sure who they think the Mashiach is, or even if they look at it. But in Hebrew, even the tabernacle, the Mishkan, was anointed Mashiach. The kings were Mashiach. The priests, the Kohanim, were Mashiach. The King David was a Mashiach. We've had Mashiachim all throughout the ages. When Yeshua came, they believed he was the Mashiach. And many people believe he was the Mashiach of his day. He was trying to bring the people back to Torah. And in that way, and he was anointed. We are waiting today. The whole of Judaism is waiting for a Mashiach. Who or what? We don't know. We're going to have to wait and see. All the furniture at the altar and the vessels were anointed Mashiach. Then the princes of Israel, the heads of their houses, were offered. The princes, they were counted. They brought their offering before the Lord. Now this is pay attention to what's coming next, because it's very important. 6 covered wagons and 12 oxen, a wagon for every 2 of the princes, for each one an ox, and they presented them before the Mishkan. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take it from them, that they may do the service of the Ochel Moed, the tent of meeting. This is for the princes of Israel. The oxen, Moses took the wagons and the oxen and gave them to the Levi'im, to the Levites. This is what he gave them. 2 wagons, 4 oxen, he gave to the sons of Gershon for their service. He gave 4 wagons and 8 oxen to the sons of Merari, because their service needed a double amount for the things that they had to carry, large poles, and they were going to need 4 wagons instead of 2 and 8 oxen instead of 4. To the sons of the Kohat, he gave none, because the service of the holy things belonged to them. They bore them upon their shoulder, and the princes brought the dedication offerings of the altar in the day that it was anointed. Even the princes brought their offerings before the altar. The Lord said to Moses, they shall present their offering, each prince on his day for the dedication of the altar. So now the princes of 12 tribes all had to bring something for the dedication of the altar. Remember when they were building the Mishkan? Now everybody was going to be bringing. These things were all given to them when they left Egypt. Remember how God put it on the heart of the Egyptians to give them silver and gold and all kinds of fabrics and things that they were going to use for the altar in the desert. So here we see, remember there's 12 tribes. On the first day, we see Nachshon, the son of Amminadab, of the tribe of Judah. Isn't it interesting? It doesn't start with Reuben, who was the first son. It starts with Judah, the fourth son. Judah is the one who would inherit the line of King David and the whole Messianic era, according to those who believe in the Messiah. But it's the future of the people of Israel, because from Judah came the Yehudim. The Yehudim means the praisers of God. Reuben lost his position when he slept with his father's concubine. Simeon and Levi, the next two boys, they lost their position when they went and they murdered when Dina was raped. They murdered all the men of the village. So they lost it. So now it fell on Judah. He was the one who would be placed the highest of all the tribes and from whom we all come today. So this was their offering. Judah was to bring one silver dish weighing 130 shekels, one silver basin of 70 shekels, according to the shekel of the sanctuary, both of them full of fine flour mingled with oil as a meal offering, one golden pan of 10 shekels full of incense, one young bull, one ram, one male lamb in the first year as an olah, a burnt offering, one male of the goats for a sin offering. For the sacrifice of peace offering, remember there were 5 types of offerings. We had the olah, the chatat, the shelamim. Here, for the shelamim, 2 oxen, 5 rams, 5 male goats, 5 lambs. That was the offering of Nachshon, the son of Amminadab. Then we come to the second day. The second son, second prince is Netanel, the prince of Issachar. That's another tribe. And when we read it, we see one silver dish, 130 shekels, one silver basin, 70 shekels, after the shekel of the sanctuary, both of them full of fine flour, a golden pan, a young bullock, one ram, one male, all exactly the same as Judah, as Yehuda. Then we go to the third day, and we have Eliab, the son of Elon, from the tribe of Zebulun. We read it again, the exact same things. One silver dish, one silver basin, one golden pan, etc., etc. Then on the fourth day, Elitzur, the son of Shedeur, this is from Reuben. And what do they bring? One silver dish, one silver basin, one golden pan, again, over and over. The fifth day from Simeon, one silver dish. I'm not going to read them all again because we're going to see. Sixth day, the prince of Gad. Next tribe, exactly the same. The seventh day, Elishama from Ephraim. The offering was one silver dish, one golden pan, all exactly the same. The eighth day, Gamaliel from the tribe of Manasseh. So we have Ephraim and Manasseh, who were both the sons of Joseph. Remember, Joseph had a double blessing because there now are not 12 tribes. There are 13 tribes, and one of them was set apart to be the Levi'im, the Levites, who were to serve, whereas all these were to march in the armies, and they all brought exactly the same. On the ninth day, children of Benjamin brought the same thing. The tenth day, Ahiezer, the children of Dan, same things. The 11th day, Asher, all exactly, not even one little thing different. And the 12th day, Naphtali, all of them brought the same thing. Why? I remember our rabbi talking about how each of us is so precious in God's eyes. We are equal in value in his eyes. And that's why it's repeated over and over. Because they could have said, the first one was Judah, and all the other tribes brought the same. But no, each were given the same honor of bringing all these same things. Can you imagine the parading that took place of bringing all these things to offer before God? This was the dedication offering of the altar on the day when it was Mashiach anointed at the hand of the princes of Israel. 12 silver dishes, 12 silver basins, 12 golden pans, each silver dish weighing 100. I'm not going to read it all, but you see all the offerings. And when Moses went into the tent of meeting that he might speak with him, God would speak with Moses. He heard the voice, call, the bat call, speaking to him from above the ark cover that was upon the Aron of the Edut, the ark of the testimony, from between the two Keruvim, the two angels, and God spoke to Moses. I mean, how powerful is that? God entered the tent of meeting with all, after all these things had been offering, he presented himself before God and he heard the voice of God. How many of us would love to hear the voice of God? Some have. Some of us have seen him act in our lives in miraculous ways. But it's not about a religion. These things that they did had nothing to do with establishing a religion. It had to do with slowly weaning us away from paganism, from the paganism of Egypt, and slowly bringing us to be in a relationship with our Creator. So unless we understand it from the Hebraic perspective, we will never understand the heart of God. Although it is very difficult to understand his heart, but he certainly understands ours. So that was this week, Naso. And I hope that you got something out of it. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to ask. If I can't find the answer, then maybe you'll have the answer for us. But you see, the most important thing to realize is that the people who stood at the base of Mount Sinai were not rabbis. They were not pastors. They were not theologians. They were not doctors of philosophy. They were simple people who fought every step of the way and complained all through the 40 years in the desert. But they had in their hands what I have in the back, right up here. I don't know if you can see where my arrow is pointing, the Ten Commandments, so that they would learn slowly how to apply them to their lives and how to trust in the Creator. Because we need to go from faith emunah, which is a gift given to us, to bitachon, to trusting him. That is why we struggle. We'll never struggle if our faith is not put into question. If we don't have struggles, we will never develop bitachon, trust. And then God checks our heart to see our kavanah, our intention. And then that's how we're judged, by the intentions of our heart. Because he gave us free will to choose him, to choose to obey him or not to obey him. So on that note, I say good evening and God bless you, and repeating the Yivarechecha, the Aaronic benediction for all of us. It's so powerful. So have a wonderful evening, and God bless you, and hopefully we'll see you next week. I can say Shabbat Shalom.